Lots of people wear gadgets that give real-time data. Some apps claim that these signals reveal your level of stress. But can stress really be detected from mere heartbeats? When your heart is racing, does it necessarily mean that you're stressed? Or did you just move your body?
Yo, what the f-?
Or are you angry? Or finding a little moment of joy? Maybe you had a bit too much coffee. Because when it comes to the question of what your heart rate means, psychologically speaking, the scientifically correct answer is, it depends. That's because physical signals from within your body have no inherent psychological meaning. A particular heart rate does not indicate any particular emotional state. It's not the case, say, that 100 beats per minute is happiness and 150 beats per minute is anger. The pounding heart in your chest during instances of both emotions can be physically identical. More specifically, your heart rate may vary just as much among different instances of anger as it does between instances of anger and happiness. Ditto for every spurt of cortisol, every trickle of dopamine, and every other electrical or chemical change in your body. What differs is the meaning that your brain makes of the physical signals in a particular context. The same is true for physical signals from the outside world. When a tree falls in the forest and slams into the ground, but no one is present, it does not make a sound. It does produce a change in air pressure. That change becomes meaningful to you as a sound only when it reaches sensory surfaces inside your ear, called your cochlea, producing a different physical signal that travels up to your brain, where it meets an ensemble of other signals that represent your knowledge of falling trees and what they sound like. You don't hear with your ears, you hear with your brain. If that same change in air pressure encounters your rib cage rather than your cochlea, you may feel a thudding in your chest rather than hear a sound. Light waves similarly exist in the physical world, whether or not a human is present. But color is a feature constructed as your brain weaves those signals together with others of its own creation. So a statement like, "The rose is red," is more precisely stated as, "I experience the wavelengths of light reflected from the rose as red." The redness isn't in the rose. The light waves detected by the sensory surface in your eye, your retina, modulate signals along the optic nerve that encounter other signals in your brain that resemble past experiences and give those incoming signals psychological meaning. And voila, you experience the rose as scarlet, ruby, or some other variety of red. Your brain constantly runs a model of your body as it moves through the world. You come to know that world only through your cochlea, retina, and the other sensory surfaces of your body. Their signals continuously confirm or correct the ongoing signals in your brain. The implication is a bit startling. You cannot experience the world or even your own body objectively. Your experience is always from a particular perspective, and no perspective is universal. Your brain's internal model is formed from ensembles of sensory signals from your past, sourced from the body it is attached to, the world that surrounded it, and the other people who curated and inhabited that world. Their words and actions wired your brain with the concepts of your culture, empowering your brain to see red in a rose, hear trees fall, and understand your racing heart as joy in one situation and sorrow in another. This idea, called relational meaning, is familiar in quantum physics. As Carlo Rovelli beautifully explained in his book Helgoland, nature is not filled with permanent objects, but with relations between quantities. When an electron is not interacting with anything, it has no physical properties. An electron only has a position or a velocity relative to something else. The same is true for signals that arrive at the sensory surfaces of your body, whether the signals originate within your body or outside it. they become psychologically meaningful only in relation to the electrical and chemical activity in your brain, a brain that continually creates a culturally infused internal model of your body as it moves through the world. Some experiences, like imagining the future and reliving events from the past, are constructed completely by the signals within your brain. Even some sensations are entirely your brain's constructions. An example is the feeling of wetness. Your skin has no sensors for moisture, so how is it that you feel wet when you take a swim or get caught in the rain? Your brain constructs this sensation by combining physical signals from sensory surfaces for temperature and touch, and entwining them with other signals that reassemble your knowledge of what wetness feels like. Everything you see, hear, smell, or taste, every touch you feel, and every action you take arises from a complex web of interwoven signals. And some of the most important signals are found only in your brain. Your brain does not detect features in the world and body. It constructs features to make meaning, relational meaning. Some constructed features are closer in detail to raw sensory data, such as lines and edges and color. Scientists call these physical features. Mental features are more abstract. When you appreciate a beautiful painting, the beauty is not in the painting. It's created in your brain. When you eat a delicious dinner, the deliciousness is not in the meal, but constructed in your head. Relational meaning also holds a key to understanding how emotions work. If you watch a world chess match and see a player scowl, it may seem to you that you are detecting anger in their face, but really you are experiencing that chess player as angry. That experience is constructed in your brain by giving meaning to sensory signals that have no objective emotional meaning of their own. Pursed lips, flushed skin, and a rapid heart rate are not inherently emotional. These physical signals take on emotional meaning only in relation to other signals, some of which are your past experiences that have been wired into your brain by other people in your culture. In this complex web of context, a grandmaster's scowl might mean anger, about 30% of the time, studies show, but can also mean that they're concentrating hard, or even that they have bad gas. If you find some of these ideas unintuitive, I am right there with you. Relational meaning, the idea that your experience of the world says as much about you as it does about the world, is not extreme relativism. It's a relativism that differs from the usual dichotomy drawn between materialism, the idea that reality exists in the world and you're merely a spectator, and idealism, the idea that reality exists only in your head. It's an acknowledgement that the reality you inhabit is partly created by you. You are an architect of your own experience. Meaning is not infinitely malleable, but it is much more malleable than most people think. So, what does all this mean for your everyday life? If physical signals from your body and from the world only become meaningful to you in relation to signals created in your brain, this means that you have a bit more responsibility than you might realize for how you experience and act in the world. For the most part, meaning-making is automatic and outside of your awareness. When you were a child, other people curated the environment that wired experiences into your brain, seeding your brain's internal model. You're not responsible for this early wiring or for the meanings that it engenders. But as an adult, you have the capacity to challenge those meanings and even change them. That's because your brain is always tweaking its internal model, creating an opportunity for new meanings with every new ensemble of signals that it encounters. To influence your internal model, you can effortfully seek out new meanings. You can expose yourself to people who think and act differently than you do, even if it's uncomfortable. And it will be. The new experiences you cultivate will manifest as signals in your brain and become raw material for your future experiences. In this way, your brain has some choices in how it gives meaning to a racing heart, whether it's a chess champion's or your own. You don't have unlimited choice in this regard, but everybody has a little bit more choice than they might realize. By embracing this responsibility, you grant yourself more agency in how you automatically make meaning, and therefore over your reality and your life.